Okay, it's been a long time. As per usual, I don't have much time. All right, what's going on? Okay, there we go. Sound, a little bit of gain, a little bit of gain, sound. Okay, so I'll check the sound on this a little bit later. We've got some interesting audio characteristics here in the room. Anyway, I'll do what I can to make it better. So there we go. Okay, so it's been a couple of months. I haven't been able to make videos because of a number of intrusions on time and circumstances. My wife's been ill. We've had emergency room rush to the hospital kind of things. Hopefully that's abated now, and we're beyond that. So I feel a little comfortable taking some time to do this. Another thing that's intruded was that I had to wait for certain stages in the patent process before I could talk about this stuff. And so now I have that first minimal level of protection, having filed these patents, etc. And so I can get into some of the non-patentable aspects of what I've discovered, which is what we're calling the high effect. I've been talking with people in the magnet business, a couple of academics in engineering and physics, and there isn't a consensus on an understanding of what's actually occurring, okay? I can tell you what there are various different aspects of what we think may be occurring, but we don't have anything definitive yet, so some of these other people are going to go and test it. But there is indeed an effect. We're calling it a high effect, as opposed to for sure stating that we've got a blended, I'm using that word advisedly, but a blended dielectric constant across multiple magnetized objects. So I'll get into that in a minute. So it was my wife's health, the patent process, and the business aspects around the patent process for this magnet stuff. And then also the this damn lawsuit shit, right? Because I am being sued for inventing the term blue chicken cult, blue space chicken cult, and copywriting it, using it in a fictional work, and trademarking it, okay? All of which are legal activities, absolutely legal activities, and I'm being sued for it. I'm not alone. There's 8 or 9 other people. They just keep throwing more people in all the time. The plaintiff has now decided that maybe people that are hacking his Twitter account in order to bomb his followers with scams, maybe they're also going to be thrown into this. So so the lawsuit is just a royal pain in the butt. And it's an interesting process, okay, because they have no jurisdiction over me, personal jurisdiction. They have no subject matter jurisdiction because I'm being sued for trademarking blue space chicken cult. But the Patent and Trademark Office granted that. So that's legal. So the jurisdiction in this thing is all muddied because of the subject matter, right? Usually, see, the thing is, you can't have, technically, it's not possible to have somebody's trademark be offended by somebody else's trademark, because that's the Patent Office. That's what they're supposed to do. The U.S. Patent and Trademark Office is supposed to keep all that shit straight so that that doesn't happen. But I'm being sued for this anyway. It's cost a shitload of money, okay? It's cost like, not new car money, but fucking close. And it's outrageous. So I'm not going to say that my wife's health was made worse by the stress and anxiety of what was going on as a result of this spurious, inauthentic case. And I'm not going to go into why it's inauthentic, but it's bogus, okay? But the thing was, she was definitely stressed out by it. What was stressing her was this bleed rate, paying these attorneys to go to useless meetings with each other over this process. And I'll go through it real quick because I got to get on with this magnet stuff because I've got real work to do. Okay, so here is the concept. The concept is that the plaintiff has got a bag. This is my bag of pure sleep stuff, right? Actually, I'm not going to muddy it by associating it with the plaintiff. Okay, so we're going to use a box. All right, so the plaintiff has a case, and they stick it in the box. They present it to a court. Now, until the court actually can assign a date and make sure that all of the shit's right, they don't look inside the box. All right? They don't examine the case. They don't do any of that shit. So we have been spending months fighting about the handling of the box, not really what's in the box. And mostly we haven't been fighting about it. We've been paying attorneys to talk to each other on the telephone with the plaintiff's attorneys about this box. And so until we examine the contents of the box, the judges won't know that it's 100% bogus, bullshit, made up. It's all full of, you know, confetti and cut up paper and no there, right? And so, but until we examine the contents of the box and get to that stage, which who the hell knows when that's going to be, they can't throw it out. They can't run the dismissal on it and stuff, right? In the meantime, we're bleeding money. And my wife, this is my retirement money. So the plaintiff, I will refrain from pejorative terms, the plaintiff is attempting a strategy, in my opinion, that is duplicitous and extremely hurtful and is very evil. Because, see, these are my retirement dollars. So really upset my wife to have a bleed out at a rate of about $30,000 every couple of months. You know, because attorneys are not cheap, and I've got to hire an attorney in Colorado. So basically what I did was, in order to short-circuit the whole process. All right, so let me say the strategy is that I don't think the plaintiff knows, or I don't think the plaintiff thinks he may be dumb. I don't know what the fuck's going on with that mind. But there's nothing in the box that the plaintiff can use to win a lawsuit against me. Okay, we're not at that level to where we're arguing about the inside the contents of the box yet, where I can prove that it's 100% bullshit. We're just arguing about the box being moved around and who's got to do something to the box and all this kind of shit at this stage. Well, that itself is a strategy, all right? It took me a while, okay? I'm stupid. I'm not a very savvy person relative to passive-aggressive attacks and that kind of stuff. In other words, people can be very passive-aggressive to me, and I might get 20 miles down the road before it finally dawns on me, oh, shit, it was one of those passive-aggressive things. And then next time I deal with them, you know, I don't deal with it, right? So if I find you're being passive-aggressive with me once, you've violated the integrity of a relationship by not being honest, and so I'll never, ever, ever deal with you again if I can possibly avoid it. And if I do have to deal with you again, it will be confrontationally from that point forward, forever and ever and ever. It's just the way my mind has to operate. So, anyway, one of these things is that one way to win a court case is to win with the contents of your box, right? Another way to win in a much more effective way is to win by costing your enemies, the defendants in this case, money as they argue about who has the box, where it's being moved around, who's got custody of it, all that kind of shit, and drag that stuff out as long as possible just to suck money out of them. So I'm stupid, right? I didn't see this. I thought the guy was legitimately trying to put forth a case that I just got that I had fallen into, so to speak, or been swept up into because of his dislike of my criticism of him stealing my material from my reports and then all of his defaming and slandering of me, right? Which I was, you know, I didn't suffer him as a fool, so I would say it, you know, plaintiff has slandered me this way, and I'd bitch and fight at him on YouTube. Or not, well, YouTube very minimally, but on Twitter. I, you know, tell him he was being wrong on Twitter. So I thought I was being swept up into a legitimate case. I no longer think that, because as a defendant, I get to look at the contents of the box, even though the judges aren't. because the judges are so backed up in Colorado. Apparently, Colorado is a hub for processing all kinds of federal prisoner lawsuits, so all the judges are always overworked. And so it might be months before they get around to looking at this stuff. And so I'm not actually being sued yet. We're just still wrangling over jurisdiction, right? The suit has not actually gone forward. It hasn't moved. We're just wrangling over the box, who's in the box, who's going to be affected by the box, and so on. Well, here's the thing. I think they're using the other strategy because I can see the inside of the box as a defendant. Anybody can. You can go get a count on PACER, and it's the federal system for managing court documents, and cost you 10 cents a search. You can go look up the case number and go and read all the documents to your heart's content. And they've been moving the bar. They've been doing what's shifting the goalpost kind of thing further and further down the field, just basically dragging it all out. So I sort of tumbled to this as a potential idea as a method of winning. How could they win this way? Well, if they would rack up 4 or 5 or 6 or 7 months more. And they were talking about discovery. Now, that's another thing to even worry about. But they were talking about discovery going out into August of next year. And so if they were that kind of a, that was what clued me in. Okay, this is not a legitimate suit. This is a man-in-the-middle attack. It's a variant of the man-in-the-middle attack, right? Where you're playing all the parties off against each other in order to use them as pawns in a wider game. And so what they were doing is they were trying to eat up attorney fees by meeting after meeting after meeting, document after document after document, because of the way the court system has to work. I won't go into it. But it was just costing everybody in the defendant side lots and lots of money. And so I could no longer afford that, and I could no longer afford the toll it was taking on my wife's health. And so I didn't. All right, so I fired my attorneys. They weren't very aggressive. They don't know how to fight. They didn't, in my opinion. And so I fired my attorneys and put it on myself and started learning very, 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 very rapidly. Coming up from behind, I pissed the judge off with this one thing because I wasn't, I wasn't cool about how I asked for something. I didn't understand the rules and what I was doing and so on. But I'm catching up with it now. And it's, the doctors use Greek, lawyers use Latin, and I know Latin, right? And so I'm able to just go through all of that. It's no problem. I can do the research. So, you know, so I'm a much better fighter. And the thing is, turns out, guys, if you're pro se, which means for yourself in Latin, for self, if you're pro se, you don't have to argue law because you can argue fact. Because these people are, in the description of it all, they are to find fact. So, great. I don't have to go to obscure laws. I don't have to care about Iqbal versus, the great toothbrush explosion in 1887 or whatever the hell it was, all these weird obscure cases and that kind of stuff. It matters. I need to know about it. There were a couple of them I were able to defeat because of the, or in my mind anyway, we haven't had any even examination of it, because I did understand what was going on with it, but it's not necessary. You can argue fact. Anyway, so now I'm arguing. So now that aspect, that one whole strategy, is no longer valid. He's not costing me any more money because all he's doing is impacting my time. And I'm throwing my attorney fees back on him. Sorry. There's the kicker, right? They drive up your costs, and then when their case collapses because the box is full of dog shit and confetti and paper and stuff, then they declare bankruptcy after they've had all the attorney fees put back on them. And then they walk, right? They just resurrect somewhere else under a new identity or under a new scheme or whatever. And they never worry about paying off the hundreds of thousands of dollars that have now been invested spuriously, needlessly, wastefully in attorneys over a case that never should have been brought forward. Yeah, I think it's a screwy way to work the courts, but I understand why they're doing it that way and why they have to do it that way. And it is mind-boggling that they are as bound by their protocols and as screwed by them as they are. But it makes it very easy to game the central or the federal lawsuit business, right? I mean, what I've learned in the past couple of months is just staggering. You apply game theory to it and do your own work and you're golden. Anyway, so that has taken up a lot of my time. And it's much more than I can possibly go into ever. All right, so I got to get moving on with this. So so I'm doing the thing pro se. When it's all done, when it's all released and all of that kind of stuff, I'll come on out and go into it with some detail. I'll probably talk to some of the other defendants online just to like do a debrief, get rid of some of the emotion that's been heaped on us and that kind of thing. But also, by the way, I do have a just a genius idea that had actually, I'd had the idea and started working on it back in probably, I'm gonna say maybe December of 2014 or January-ish 2015, right around in that period. And so, but I had to let it go, the cancer, you know, my mother's death, all of this other stuff going on. But it was, I thought it was an interesting idea, and it's kept, you know, rattling around in there, and it stuck, and it's like, okay, I can work on that now. So after the lawsuit's gone and all of that kind of stuff, I'm gonna bring out something absolutely brand new, totally unexpected. It'll be a little bit more perfected than the usual kinds of haphazard approach to things, because it's gonna be a group effort. I'm gonna involve other people, that sort of thing. And they won't let it be too sloppy, but it ought to be really fucking cool. All right, so now let's get on with the magnet stuff. And this is the hard part. So I'm gonna turn, let's check the sound. It's still good, sound, come on. Sound, okay. All right, so I wanna deal with three uses of, so this is in essence a statement of prior art. So if you're looking at this, you could use it as prior art, you can cite it as prior art in patent applications, right? I'm telling you right now, I've got patent applications for the art in these three areas, okay? Shielding, rigidity, and shock absorbing. It's the shoe part fits under the shock absorbing. That's the really cool part. That's what's progressing us along, oddly enough. All right, so I need to make people understand a goofiness about magnets. All right, so you can have a circular magnet. These are all individual magnets that are all oriented now in a plus to minus. We'll just use those as our standard reference, okay? We're actually using centrifugal and centripetal now. But a plus to minus approach in a circle, as we see here. Each one of these individual magnets has a dielectric central point in a dielectric inertial plane. Don't worry about the language as we go along, right? Dielectric inertial plane. That is a plane of activity that is created when we create a magnet. It disturbs the ether and it causes the ether to, let's just use a word, outgas, okay? I mean, it causes a pressure gradient fluctuation, a perturbation. It's kind of like an active sense of wrinkling your skin, right? As I wrinkle my skin and twist it here, I'm not aware of it at a particular level unless I push too hard and it becomes painful, but my skin is actually reacting to being twisted. It's attempting to not break, it's attempting to be, you know, resilient and not separate and do all these things. It's actually reacting to it. And so it's reacting in an active way. Blood may be being blocked because I might be blocking something here. So it does exist that way. This is the analogy that we're going to use at the moment for the creation of a magnet. Because what you do is you shock a magnetized object, this black circle, and you shock it and it creates this dielectric central point. And that is the center point where I would pinch in my skin before I started to flex and bend my skin, bending the fabric of my body, so to speak, right? Okay, so this dot is shocked in one of these magnets. These magnets are neodymium, iron, and boron mixed up in a slurry and put into molds and many different ways of drying them. But anyway, so it's a lattice. Ceramic lattice, it's baked, very much like any other ceramic in a kiln to a certain temperature and yada, 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 and then it's electrically shocked after it's had its chrome coating on it. So it's not metal. It looks like metal, but it's not. Or rather, it's not a solid metal as we would normally think of the ferrous magnets, right? The bar magnets. I don't have any here. There are some over there. All of these magnets here that are all stuck together are all having their dielectric planes all point inward to the center of this mass. So in this sense, their dielectric planes are all, this is going to be very difficult, are all going into the towards the center of where that little dot is on my thumb. The dielectric planes, in that sense, would be in between the poles, and they would all be pointing in like this. Now, they're not meeting. In this particular arrangement here, there's no meeting of the dielectric planes at all. There's the dielectric plane exists outside the magnet to some extent, and when you see the dielectric plane in a particular format, which I'll attempt to show you, it's very difficult, it is bulky and it sort of glistens in the ferrofluid, and it is somewhat active. It sort of quivers. Around here, we have these spirals, okay? These centrifugal spirals that go out forever from that pole. Here, we have centripetal spirals in. And this creates sort of this fuzzy effect at the poles. Now, the fuzzy effect is from like this, all the way around. And if you wanted to go and look at a very good two-dimensional pictures of magnets, you could go to Ken Wheeler's Ken Wheeler, look him up on YouTube. Theoria something, I can't remember, Apophis, I think, is his YouTube channel. Anyway, he's got some ferrofluid pictures and ferrocell pictures that are really good. It didn't do us any good, right? I didn't go that route because I was looking for something in a three-dimensional level for what I wanted to do here. Okay, so now, we've had some people in there. You'll be familiar with the fact that I've done this thing that I call blending and folding of magnetic fields. And that's the basis of all of these inventions. All right, so here is a standard arrangement of those magnets. And it is not possible. All right, so I'm going to separate them out. There's three magnets forming a little triangle, equilateral, equiangular triangle. Okay, so it is not possible for me to do a cannonball stack. It's not possible for me to take a magnet and put it in the middle here, in between these other guys. As we approach, no matter which direction we approach, there will be a reaction, and it'll go on in and it'll form this arrangement. So that is the natural arrangement of these magnets. So they can be squished together, they can be separated. And so what I'm about to show you is an unnatural, natural effect, okay? So I cannot patent this effect. But what I'm actually doing, all right, so here we have, where'd it go? There it is. Okay, so here we have the three magnets in the little triangle, okay? And as I had shown you, now in this case, the dielectric in this sense, we have the poles touching each other, what we think of the poles, and then we have these dielectrics, the middle planes, through each of the magnets, all being oriented this way. And so they're oriented inward. And that's a natural occurrence if you put three magnets, if you put four, five, six, and so on, they'll all continue to orient the dielectric plane perpendicular to the connection within that plane. And so as we've shown, it's not possible to make them go into a cannonball arrangement by just stacking them or setting them one on top of another. But it is possible, if you know the trick to it, to cause the dielectric planes to blend, so that we're no longer, the reason we can't do a cannonball stack here is because one or more of the poles will want to become involved in the process, and it will separate from that triangle. Hopefully all this sound is good. All right, so I'm going to go ahead and do that, and we now have a cannonball stack arrangement of magnets. Now, this is not a natural process. Okay, this is the high effect. You're looking at it right there, demonstrated in these 3/8-inch neodymium permanent magnets. Okay, there's very strange shit going on in here. All right, so this is a ferrofluid jar. It's got ferrofluid in there. And you can see that I'm drawing, I don't know if we can actually see that or not. That's the problem. I'm drawing some of the ferrofluid over to this, and we see that we do not have any longer the approximation. Hang on. It's touchy, this high, like me, it's touchy, this high effect. Okay, so there, that's what a magnet does, okay? It creates these, in the ferrofluid there, this is the effect of the poles, the centripetal and centrifugal poles causing their spirals outward of the energy, causing the iron filings in this fluid to react as I move the magnet around. It's very difficult to see. You almost have to have one of these. Now, this magnet is just laid up against it, and you can barely see. Let me see if I can get some light at a different angle. You can barely see the smooth part in the middle of an ordinary magnet, okay? So this is a single magnet that I'm holding up against the side, and you see the spikes at the top and the spikes at the bottom as we get the centrifugal and centripetal forces. And then there's this smooth band in the middle. The smooth band in the middle occupies about 2/3 of that space. This area here, okay? So if we were to slice it this way, you get about 2/3 and the rest, and then you got a 6th there and a 6th there. This is the manifestation of the dielectric plane as it interacts with the iron filings. Now, what we're doing here is that I'm no longer in, I'm doing a process here. It doesn't do me any good to show it to you, but basically I'm just twisting it and twisting one of the magnets while I hold the other three, and then they'll all twist. You have to, all four of them have to be involved in order for this, the high effect to actually be created. And then you get it there, okay? And so there's the high effect. That's an unnatural arrangement of very high power magnets. Hang on a second. It can be very damaging. I've been doing a lot of this with demos this past few weeks. It's very touchy because it is a magnet that is no longer joined at the poles. This is a magnetic structure that is now bound, if I can do it again, not at the poles, but by intermixing and blending the dielectric inertial planes. And that's what you produce, okay? Now, okay, big whoop, big deal. Well, the big deal is that this structure here does not, it no longer has ordinary magnetic properties. It has interesting magnetic anomaly properties, which we'll get into real quick. So this is an ordinary magnet. If I put a bunch of them side by side, they'll all work this way. They'll all have the same alignment, you know, north and south. They'll stick north to south and so on, but they'll always have this particular arrangement. When you do that high effect, you're actually taking the hair, so to speak, up there and down here and twisting them all in together around and internally into the dielectric plane. Very difficult to describe two-dimensionally because you almost have to have the drawings we've come up with to get a real good idea as to what we think is occurring. All right, so we have our arrangement of stacked magnets. And then we have the central magnet right there. Okay, so I'm gonna redraw this one. This is the best way we can do to describe it. All right. I'm going to redraw it so I can show you what actively occurs. So here we have magnet, magnet, magnet. There's poles joining right at those points right there. That's the actual join of the centrifugal forces. It's fairly wide. We put another one on there, indicated in red. Now, the reason to indicate it in red is because here's what you're going to have to do in order to duplicate what I've just done. You're going to have to take the attached magnet. You cannot do it by separating and bring it in. It won't work that way. It does work by holding them, and if you've got really strong hands or a small enough magnet with a low enough power, you can do it this way. You can bring it in and twist it in place, but that's what it is. And this thing has arity and chelerity, okay? It has handedness, left and right handedness. So what we do, there's two forms of it here, okay? So the first form we get is repulsive and ambient. And the second form we get is attractive, minor, and ambient. Now we're starting to get into some really screwy stuff. We've had to invent this shit as we've gone along, myself and these other individuals that are trying to discuss what's happening. All right, so let's try attractive, medium, and ambient as our, so we'll do number two first. Okay, so in order to create the number two effect here, I take this magnet that is the attaching or the central or the key magnet, if it were to come down right here, this would pop apart and it would want to come into this four magnet shape here. But what we actually do is we rotate it. And you can rotate it, of course, obviously right or left. If you rotate to the right, there is a specific number of degrees that you go to and this effect starts to occur. And then it gets to a certain point and it locks. So that locking point is about 35 to 37 degrees on spherical magnets. You can do it with other shaped magnets as well. Okay, so it is now locked in the second one here, attractive, minor, ambient. That should be A and B, but anyway. Okay, so let me explain the attractive and the, you use this mode here for a shield. All right, so as I say, I've got patents on it. I'm gonna just show you how it goes because there's a key element here I'll discuss that we, unless you know what you're doing, and even yet we have not figured out a way to do it industrially. All right, but here's the deal. So we're gonna make a magnetic shield. The idea is to create a barrier through which magnetism will not pass. Okay, so the idea is that we want to stop the magnetism. Most things that will react with magnetism, they react. So if you bring a magnet in this way to a barrier, and the barrier is metal or whatever, the barrier will warp to the magnet. And then once the magnet touches the barrier itself becomes magnetized, thus intruding the magnetism this side of the barrier. We want to prevent that. We want to prevent it without using vast quantities of interleaving metals and all this other stuff, right? You can stop magnetic fields now, but usually it's through mass. This approach doesn't use mass. You could, if this is miniaturized, if this approach is miniaturized and put through an industrial process and it's created, and you had little tiny micromagnets, bazillions of them, you could put them into a fabric, and you could have micro-thin fabric that would just 100% stop magnetic field from going through. I won't go into the why, I don't have the time. That's like, we're getting into like college level shit here, or real advanced level. I mean, colleges are for daycare, but anyway, so there's our barrier. What we end up, okay, so first off, we do this, all right? So we designate these magnetic structures with the letter T. The top of the T designates this plate right here formed by the three magnets that way. And the bottom of the T represents the locking magnet that puts it into either attractive or repulsive. And so we can say that it's right or left-handed T, right? And so we can say, but what we're doing for certainty is to say repulsive or attractive. So we know which side we're dealing with. And so what we're doing is we're making a barrier here that is using our T structure this way. And so it would be described as like something like this. And so it's an attractive T structure. The attractive T structure here is these magnets, and let's just represent it as a T again. And it's basically the three magnets up here that are all glommed together, and then the one down here, right? Okay, so what's happening here is that the complex structure of the magnetic field, which I don't know if we can even show it again. This magnetic field, the dielectric inertial planes of which are all see how it's attracting all of the ferrofluid there? Okay, but it's not in a single magnet form. There's these bulges, and there's dips in between the bulges and that kind of thing. So it's extremely attractive. In a minor way, not as good as electricity, but just for a permanent magnet, pretty good, it becomes very attractive. And what it does, because of the nature of the cool aspect of the high effect, is this, the blending of the dielectric, okay? Because that prevents magnetism from an external source from going through, because it becomes involved with it. So here's the beauty of this, right? You've got our magnets right here, and then you've got your regular magnet here coming in, and it doesn't matter if it's north or south, doesn't matter which pole is there. It will be, our magnets here, if they're held rigid by this barrier structure, maybe it's sheetrock, maybe it's plastic, maybe it's put into metal, who knows? Does not matter, could be cloth. But as you bring the magnet, this magnet close to our shield here, the dielectric centers that is now joined together, the field shape of this is very much like that. I don't know if that's actually showing. Let me get another color in there, probably better. So we get this effect. It bulges out on the T side, and it warps inward like this on the attractive side. And basically what happens is that the radiation of other magnets, magnetic field, gets drawn in. As it comes close to this, it gets drawn in. And these extend out some considerable distance this way, but they do not extend beyond 1/4. There's math involved in this. It's all 1/4 of the distance squared kind of shit, right? So whatever is the entire length of the field here, the barrier component of it will be 1/4 of that entire distance of the physical shape of the magnets. So it's very easy to do the math on it and figure out exactly for, you know, it's like carpentry. So that's what works on the, that's how it works here on the attractive side. The magnetic radiation comes on in and it gets diverted into these dielectric inertial planes that are all wrapped together in this specific form. I'm working with some magnet guys. I found a Japanese firm through an Aikido buddy in Japan. He put me in contact with a scientific research outfit who happens to have an association with a collective or a corporation that has an interest in a firm here, and they put me in contact with a firm in the U.S. that does specialty magnet construction. And we're going to try and do some interesting, I put them under a memorandum of understanding and an NDA and stuff. And we're going to try and duplicate this effect in without mechanically trying to do it. You know, I just do it. So you can create the magnets all in that form, because see, here's the thing. All right, so so that's, all right, so let me go into these others real quick, and then I'll go into the big stuff and the reason that I'm sharing all of this. All right, so if we were going to do the first one here, the repulsive, then we get this effect, okay? Let me draw it again. All right, so we have our T And we're going to do a repulsive, which is the, actually it's a left hand. You have to twist to the left. And it's half the degrees. So curiously, to lock it, it's about 35 to 37 degrees. Twisting to the right to get attractive, and it's about 15 to 17 degrees twisting to the left to get the repulsive. Now, the repulsive, we get the same, we get an effect of a shielding sort of an effect, but not really, not the same degree. And it's dimpled, and there will be a couple of dimples in it. But here's the thing. Over here, this is a magnified magnetic field. So it would be as though I could take a regular magnet and have its repulsive part here suddenly way up here. You know, so right there I'm feeling pretty serious repulsion. Now, if it'd be like being able to get it way up here and eliminate the attractive part down here. There wouldn't be very much of any of that. Never get that loose. Anyway, so this is the repulsive part. So these are shaped magnetic fields, and they're permanently shaped that way. They won't change. Once you've got that thing locked, if you can do it the twist and everything, it's very difficult to do in spherical magnets unless you punch a hole through them, drive something in them that's metal as a stay, tweak them all together, twisted, and then put them in resin. Okay, you can do that. And I've also come up with a new way of viewing the whole dynamic of it, but it takes a lot of fucking ferrofluid and a specialized polycarbonate structure that I have yet to build. So anyway, but it'll allow us to see the thing in all of its complexity, because here's the deal. All right, sorry. I get all whipped up on where we're at now, but I got to get back to this other stuff. All right, so that's shielding, okay? The forces come on in, they get wiped out, so to speak, by the barrier here, and they never come on the other side of the barrier. So let's look at shock absorbing. Shock absorbing is the reverse of that. Let's say that this was a bumper on a car, all right? So you've got a bumper here on a car, and it's like this. And it can be, this could be, any kind of semi viscous material. And you have our T's here that are set up repulsive like this. And so all of these are repulsive going that way. And then we set up another barrier set here this way. And then the as this material deflects and deforms on your car is over here. And you're gonna hit the rhino over here. As this deforms, the magnetic forces here are going to push against each other, and they're going to interact and stop. They're going to absorb the outside force in the destruction of the magnetic forces. And here's the key of this. You can't use regular magnets in that effect, because what would happen is, in a regular magnet, if you just had two regular magnets, they're going to come close to each other like this, and then they're going to slip over. So they're actually going to enable this whole thing to collapse very rapidly, because they will not hold their position relative to each other, because the magnetic forces are so much stronger than the restraining forces of the plastic or whatever the hell you're making your bumper out of, right? This structure, though, not only does it have a physical... Not only does it have a physical restraining T, so to speak, to aid embedding in plastics and that kind of thing, but the magnetic shape of it is flat on one side with these little dimply kind of things there. It extends out further. And then this particular shape here that will not pass each other, so that it can't go around each other the way that an ordinary magnet field could slip around each other. Once you try it, you'll see it works. Anyway, so that's shock absorbing. So you can put that in your bumper, and the bumper here could use magnets to absorb force and destroy force, physical kinetic force as it's on rushing towards you. It'd be kind of like, I don't know if we, no. Anyway, so there's just no easy way to describe what would the level of force that it could absorb as it's going along. And you could tune these. Another beauty of this system is that you can take these things and make them at multiple strengths, and you could have big, strong ones on the outside going to smaller and smaller and smaller and finer ones towards the inner ones. So it would be, you know, a small shock wouldn't, so it'd be graded. So you'd have a gradation of resistance. And so the first part that would encounter it would be the minor ones, and then eventually, and it could compact and so on. It's combinoric, okay? It really builds up. That's the other part that we want to get at here, is that it builds up very rapidly, and there's a lot of usefulness in this for all of the people that are fucking around with magnets. So anybody you know that's doing free energy, anybody you know that's doing magnetic stuff, go ahead and show them this video, and they can clue into what's going on here at this end. All right, so here's the deal. Okay, so rigidity is basically the same way. These things are just twisted to a different, or the T's are set to a different angle, such that if it was a plastic beam out in space, for instance, it could be lightweight, it could be extruded, it could be 3D printing with the magnetic structures in it, and the magnetic structures, like the shock absorbing system, would interlock. You would just set them closer together so that their magnetism was interlocked and there was no distance between it. And it would start becoming rigid as soon as it's interlocked, and you just push them into wherever you want it to achieve the rigidity you want. So you could make it as rigid as, you know, five-day-old jello or a steel beam. You could just dial it basically whichever level of magnets you're using. Okay, so now here's the thing. You have a lot of people out there that are doing, attempting to do free energy stuff using magnets, and they're using the magnets continuously, constantly, only as individual magnets in series or in groups or so on. They are not in some of them are attempting to boost it. Some of them are attempting to alter the magnets in some small way, but they're always using the magnets as individual magnets. So let me just say, if you were careful, and I mean like careful, because you just can damage yourself so easy with these things. We had one of these things rupture, and I just got pelted. So I've got shrapnel bits all over me. Okay, so if you do this, and you do this carefully, even if you do it carefully, you're gonna be injured. Be advised, right? So I'm advising you that this is very dangerous stuff to mess with. Because what we're doing is we're forcing the two magnets together, in essence, with their poles, repulsive poles, and we're pushing, and we can't get them any further, and that's about the limit of our strength, but we're not doing it this way. What we're doing is we're doing that through the twisting. We're getting to a point where we're putting those competing poles, those pressurizing poles, right next to each other. And it creates this dynamic tension. And by dynamic, I am not not taking literary license. There is a dynamism, an activity level going on in this structure that does not exist in magnets held in other shapes, as long as the magnets are touching in their poles. Okay, so I've got this here, and let's see. Oh, I'm on the backside, and so this is a repulsive set. I can feel it right there doing the repulse on the backside of that. So anyway, this is a tetrahedron, all right? The platonic solids are our stepping stones to unique magnetic effects, but it's damn dangerous, because as you start scaling up, tetrahedron, cubes are dull. They don't ever really give us anything. But when you start getting up to octahedrons, and when we start getting into duodecahedrons and this kind of thing, where you're folding in these magnets, and that I cannot describe to you because it is so complex. I don't have enough time, and I got to get on with other stuff. You see, it just popped. But once you get, because they're dynamic, because they're actively trying to reshuffle and get themselves into this arrangement. So basically, universe wants four magnets to arrange itself this way if they're spherical, if they're spear-shaped, or little hourglass shapes. It wants to arrange them pole to pole. When you put them this way, it's actively now trying to not do that. So there's a level of energy involved in this now that can be extracted that is greater than that. So you can run a wire through here and you're not going to get much in the way of electricity. You alter it a little bit, put it into this shape, do it with the right hand twist because it's more effective for electricity with repulsion. And there you go. Okay, now if you can figure out a way to get a wire through there, you're going to get much more activity out of it because of the blended in inner dielectric inertial planes. But here's the really interesting part. I've taken this up a certain number of magnets, okay? You can glom them on to this and nothing happens. If you take the time and energy to build jigs, because you're going to need them, leverage jigs, because you're not strong enough, even with 3/8-inch magnets, to get much beyond 6 here, because you're going to increasingly turn the centrifugal, centrifugal and the centripetal sides into direct competition and direct opposition with other parts of the structure you're building. And so what if you take it too far, you turn one in the wrong way and it blows up on you and you end up with wherever the hell it went. There it is. Scars, I get shrapnel in my leg I had to dig out because these things shatter, right? They shatter into lots of little bits here. They're all broken and all dangerous and sharp and stuff and they get you all bloody. So be advised and wear eye protection and all of that sort of thing. Full face is better. But if you go beyond the tetrahedron, you can get to a point where you're basically, in the way we've been discussing it, you're boiling the ether, okay? You're not only just twisting it, you're twisting it inside and out, all of this kind of stuff. And you get a level of dynamic activity that is not free energy. Okay, because we have to create, we don't know how much more, if we're getting anything more by these arrangements, other than there is the perception that we're getting more energy out of what we have here in this state. But right now, it's potential energy. It's there's something going on in between these magnets, but it's not really affecting the outside world. In fact, I've actually reduced in this structure, I've actually reduced the effect of the magnetism as in space. I've actually been able, by the blending of the dielectric planes, to pull the magnetism from its usual extension into space into a smaller space. So it's like compressed magnetism. But it's very touchy. You just look at it wrong, and it starts going. But if you get up to larger ones, the level of dynamism involved is quite spectacular. I'm working on some other things, not free energy kind of extraction, but I've seen a number of people that have had, see, won't stick that way, and it will that way. Anyway, so we've got some people that are working on extracting energy with some interesting devices and so on, but they're all using magnets in a straight up and down fashion. I think they should explore the alteration of magnetic fields for different purposes, and you get different shapes and so on, and you're going to get different effects. Now, it's dangerous, super dangerous to do this with anything rectilinear, all right? So most of our damage has been done on square kind of magnets because they just, you can fold them, you can fold the fields and so forth, but they end up balancing on the points at some, or the edges at some point, and it becomes so stressed for the structure that they crumble on the edges. They start breaking down very rapidly, and that's when you get the shrapnel effect, and that's when they blow apart. I figured it would have been easier, that my idea was, oh, well, I'll stack them like Legos. No worries. Sure. Anyway, though, so there's three shapes that are safe. That's, we've got circles, we've got what we call our spear points, and we've got the opposite of the spear points, which are the hourglasses. You can fold all three of those shapes very, very effectively. The hourglass ones are harder to do the turn because you have to come up over that edge, but they do it. and they're very effective for specific kinds of shielding. Anyway, that's it. I'm going to shut down here. It's almost an hour. I was going to do live stream, but I've had so much interference with YouTube and stuff. They keep yanking my authentication in the background on some of the live stream stuff, and so I have to redo it each time, so it's just such a pain. And I was going to take questions, which would have kept me here for another couple of hours, and I really can't afford that. I got to get back in to my wife and stuff. But there's the high effect again. So you take it, right? You twist so that they all together and they want to fly apart. And you hold them together and you grab one and twist it like it was a doorknob or something. And I've done a number. I mean, I've gotten up past the octahedrons. And that's where it gets really dangerous, even at 3/8 inch. I had to drop down to 1/4 inch, and then that got really dangerous even then. But there is something here. There's some weird effect. Now, we don't, you know, the physicists and the engineers I'm involved with are saying they don't know if the field, they know that the fields are blended. We're fighting over characterization, because I think they're blended. I think we blend all the dielectric planes, and then I think we fold the fields into each other. And so it's a blended, folded, dielectric plane magnet. And it is a single structure, complex structure, delicate. It pops out instantly. But the properties don't disappear until it does pop out. That is to say that as long as it's in that structure, it will have more energy, it will have less radiation, it will have a smaller spatial effect in one direction and a larger one in another, and so on. And so those characteristics can be used, as I've demonstrated with just the 3 patents that I've got. I've got about another dozen or so written down as to ideas, but I got to get back to the Boscovich and this other project that I alluded to at the beginning of the video here. Anyway, I'll upload this and have at it, guys. Pass it around to all of the guys that are doing the free electricity shit, though, because it really is valuable. I don't know what time is in terms of how long, but at some point we'll have a process for creating this as a single lattice with the field in it. See, if you just made this in a shape, okay, so if we were to just take all of the material here, the neodymium and the ferric material and the boron, and put it into a mold that was this shape, and then cover it with these, with the chrome, and then zap it, we would not get this folded field. We get a dielectric plane that would be down in one of these magnets more than all of the others. Here it is not in either or any of the magnets more than any of the others, and in fact is actually located geometrically in the middle of the entire structure. So we can do it mechanistically now by twisting it, and we're going to work on an industrial process to create it all in a single process, and it has to do with the application of electricity, we presume. That's what these guys are investigating for me in the lab. And if we can do it, then we'll patent that process and release it. I'm not trying to make money. I'm trying to make money off of this, but I'm trying to control it because I want to get to a certain level and I want to promote the stuff, right? And I want to be involved in it. I don't need the money. That's why I'm talking about it now and putting some elements of my patents at risk. And I'm aware of this, and I'm doing this as a conscious choice because it's necessary for all of the, younger people with hair that are out there messing around with the free electricity and magnets and that kind of stuff to understand that this effect does exist and it can be useful. I'm going to pursue it. I'm working with a shoe manufacturer for really springy shoes. For instance, you had somebody that was extremely obese, very heavy. You could get shoes and you could just dial it in magnetically so they could get just the amount of resistance that they need, that kind of thing. All different kinds of uses for the shielding part, for the rigidity part, and this sort of thing, right? The shock absorbing. So Anyway, that's what I've got. That's all I can share at this stage. I'm not going to share my jigs, because mainly because I don't want to get blamed for it, right? So if you go beyond four, if you go beyond the physical manifestations of moving it with your hands, you're totally on your own. As you will discover, it is extremely dangerous and you could easily kill yourself. I don't know how fast some of these fragments fly apart, but I've got a freezer over here with a gouge in it like you'd hit it with a sledgehammer. And it was just a glancing blow of a partial magnet. Anyway, so that's where we're at. Good luck to you. You can't blame me. You're investigating this at your own risk. And hey, come back to me if you figure out something you can use it for. Patent it. Put in a preliminary patent application. Those don't cost very much. And do it yourself through U.S. Patent Office. Get an account there if you're going to get serious about it. Save yourself some money for attorneys. You can figure out the paperwork. It's not that hard. And but anyway, get back to me. Let me know what you've got going. I'm going to do more of these videos as I can. I'm still involved with the lawsuit, yada, 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 other things here. So it's going to be infrequent, and it might be a number of months. You can help us out if you want. You can buy Pure Sleep. Profits from those are going to support this endeavor and to pay for some of these science experiments here. It gets really expensive. You wouldn't believe how many magnets I've destroyed. And these things are not cheap. And I've got a butthead suing me for my own goddamn trademark. Anyway, guys, we'll get through all of that and all will be good. And I've got this scheme. I've got this scheme here that's gonna, you know, set things right and will be really fucking cool. I'm really intrigued by it, and it's fun to work on. So, okay, so live long, prosper, live long, prosper. Fold them fields.